Hi, everybody. Welcome back once again. This is Mark Lawrence, and we're all set to go against the spread on this weekend's NFL and college football cards. And guys, we're knee-deep into it, about halfway through the college football card, if you can believe it. And we're creeping up on one-third of the NFL football season. With that, I want to welcome our cast of experts into the show. Victor King from King Creole Sports will be off today. He's got a bye week this particular week. He's traveling back to Cleveland for a wedding. Nice to see Victor getting a little time off. Andy Isco from TheLogicalApproach.com in Las Vegas. How are you doing?
Doing well, Mark. It's been a good season so far. It's going by very rapidly, as I mentioned in our sound check. Half over in the pros, and almost more than a third over in the pros, and basically half over in college. The season goes quickly. The good news is that means my blue ribbon yearbook will be here in a few moments for basketball.
That's a good thing for everybody. Yes, it is. That's probably the one basketball book that anybody that's a basketball fan relies on the most, whether you're a fan or a handicapper. It's really, really good stuff.
And it's not published for bettors per se. No, there's no point spread information, but it's indispensable for people who want to learn about the teams. And season starts, I think, right before Election Day, November 4th. And these seasons don't start like with a game or two, like college football does, with those isolated games on the last Saturday in August or something. Like, basically, they go through throttle. I think there's like 200 something games the first 4 or 5 days.
I had a longtime customer. His name was Shorty Long from West Virginia. Obviously, Shorty was a nickname.
That's a great name.
Yes, who was partnered with the original Blue Ribbon Basketball Yearbook.
So it Chris was nice Wallace. Is that Chris Wallace?
Yeah, with Chris Wallace, exactly right. And Shorty passed. He retired first, and then he passed. But it's been passed down since. I think it's not even in Chris Wallace's hands anymore. I think somebody else has got it.
Correct. I think it's another Chris. I think it's Chris Dorch, actually, who does it now.
Exactly. Yeah. But he's kept up the work, and he's done a terrific job with that book. And I, like Andy, highly recommend anybody serious about basketball to pick up a copy of the Blue Ribbon.
And by the way, they now, like with your College of Pro Football preview, Blue Ribbon now offers a PDF version.
Nice. Very nice. That's good for us. Good for
which
people.
I can't use because I'm still old school. I like to be able to hold two pages in my hands as I flip back and forth, and you can't really do that easily digitally.
No, but when you're doing things like this, Andy, where we're in a camera and we're in front of people and doing things like that, it's nice to have that digital version or that PDF version because you can scan through it without looking like you're thumbing through pages, if that makes any sense. Jim Feist, Las Vegas. You mentioned the weather's real nice there right now. The weather's real nice down here in South Florida. We're having beautiful post-hurricane weather right now. How is everything going for you right now these days, Jim?
Everything's good out here. I have no complaints with this kind of weather. We had a record for over 100 degree days. We set this year. I don't know what the number was, but it was hot as hell. It's so nice now in the 70s and 80s. And I think Andy said we're going to have highs in the 70s later this week.
Yeah, I think tomorrow, Saturday, and Sunday, and then it starts going back up into the 80s. But I think the 100 degree days are a thing of the past, at least for this year. 90s, we may get a couple of more of those days by the end of the month.
Well, we're knocking on fall's door, no question about that. A good time of the year, not only for weather, but for football as well. Tony Mejia, Playbook experts and also contributor to the Sporting News. How's your football season going this year?
Football has picked up finally NFL-wise, so that's great. I think on one of the sites that I'm on, it was a 20-0 run.
Oh, so
I took a picture of it, and then I tweeted it out. I said, I'm only doing this for posterity's sake. And you know, threw myself on the don't jinx me, and then got jinxed on Monday because I was on the Jets and the under. And
now, Tony, the marketing method for that would be when you were 20-0, you take out a snapshot of the screen that showed when you were 15-0, and you post that.
Right.
So then a week later, the 20-0 goes up.
Yeah, but I haven't seen it, and since I am on different sites and they do different ways of doing it, so that one specifically stuck out. So
I can send a postcard to Greg Zuerlein for that.
Oh, yeah.
He's been doing that since the preseason. Like it looked like he was shaky in the preseason, and I'm sure the Palmer here knows all about Greg the Leg.
It was Greg the Leg. It's now Greg the Peg Leg.
It didn't help. I watch enough football to know that when a missed field goal comes, impending doom sure follows. So Didn't surprise me. But yeah, I mean, well, college football's been great all year. Conference USA's tripped me up a few times this week. I mean, FIU's quarterback got hurt on it was his own fault. He threw a pick and then tried to make a tackle, hurt his shoulder. So we will look to continue on, and it's been a good run. NBA preseason is winding down, so that means the season's what, like 8 to 10 days away.
Next Tuesday, I believe.
Yeah,
22nd.
Wow,
We're getting into the nexus of the universe, and then I Kadari Richmond's at St. John's. We were talking about college basketball off air, and then so St. John's has a shot this year with Patino coaching in Richmond and a very deep team. So looking forward to new school. College basketball.
Depending on how long the World Series goes in college basketball starting November 4th, we could have a day at some point in midweek. College football, the NFL on a Thursday, for example, Major League Baseball, the NHL, and the NBA all going at the same time on the same night.
Yeah, there is a day that is going to happen, Andy. We called it out in the coffee club. I picked it up from sportsyahoo.am or the AM. And they labeled it some name, and it's an apropos name. I don't know what it is, but we're going to see that. It's sort of like a total eclipse of sports.
So yeah,
We're going to have to start taking some anti-anxiety drugs to handle
it. That probably wouldn't hurt anybody.
And a lot of no-dos.
Greg DePalma, Greg Zuerlein, New York Jets. What's the connection there, Greg?
Well, I mean, the only thing I remember about Greg Zuerlein is the fact that last year he had a really good year. This year, I don't know anything because over the last 3 weeks, I haven't watched a single play because of the hurricane. And then this week, I really thought I was going to be able to sit down and watch the game. I went to sleep. I had to get to sleep early on Monday. I was just so tired. And I get to sleep. I'm going to watch the whole game in the morning. I go to my computer, my studio. I turn my internet on and my internet's down. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. I'm just ready to watch my first game in 2 weeks. I haven't missed a Jet meaningful game in my entire life. And now I've missed two straight games. And then I got to wait another couple hours. So finally, I know the internet's about to come on. And all of a sudden, what pops up in my email inbox is an athletic update telling me that the Bills beat the Jets last night, 23-20. I'm like, oh no, I missed it again.
And you got the worst possible news, right?
Yeah. So at least they've lost all three of the games. And at least, so I know nothing about it. I mean, of course, I watched the highlights and stuff to find out that Greg Zuerlein obviously is struggling right now. But I heard also that the penalties in the game were a disaster. That we're trying to watch that game was awful.
Yep. Yeah. They were flying.
Some kind of record. I don't know. It was crazy.
Yeah, it went both ways.
I'm wondering if there's going to be a sports book that puts a prop up this week. Which Jets receiver will Aaron Rodgers throw under the bus this week?
Well,
I don't know if you heard about that,
Dre Adams. I'll tell you that right now.
Well, it's Mike Williams' fault.
Yeah, but you don't do it publicly. You take him aside in the locker room and, you know, put him out. This team is dysfunctional. It's a bad situation going on right now with the Jets.
Aaron throwing all decorum out the window this season.
Tell me, since we're talking about that, I'd like to just ask a question. Pittsburgh opened a 1-point favorite in this game. Now, honest to God, I'm almost at the point where I can take three with Pittsburgh.
I'm looking for it.
I have no idea.
What the hell's going on?
I'm with you, Jim, because I am shocked. I was shocked that the Jets were a 1-point dog, let alone now a 1-point favorite. Why are they a favorite?
It was the Davante Adams trade that the Jets got.
Davante Adams trade, and Russell Wilson's probably going to start. So.
Yeah. By the way, I don't know if we got a chance to talk about that. Pittsburgh's really in a great situation because they can come up with two quality quarterbacks. They can come up with two different game plans, one for the first half, one for the second half, one for the first drive, one for the second drive. That just diverts an awful lot of a preparation time for upcoming opponents if they've got to prepare for two quality quarterbacks, especially if Pittsburgh shows that they're not afraid to use them either by half or by drive by drive or as the mood suits Mike Tomlin.
Do you think Mike Tomlin would do that, Andy? That's a great game plan.
I think he should. I think he should consider it and come up with a good explanation why he doesn't think it would work.
You know, they fired Sala. Yeah. Now, he was known as a great defensive coordinator. He was with San Francisco, came over to the Jets, and they have very good defense. Now he's gone. They got a new defensive coordinator, new offensive play caller, and a new head coach.
and the defensive coordinator is now the interim coach. So the one strength of the Jets is now being spread out.
Don't we expect a little bit of a fall off on the defense?
Yeah, especially with Adams in the lineup and Aaron Rodgers putting a smile on his face finally. Having, you know, he's got a real great 1-2 passing combo there with Garrett Wilson. So he's feeling pretty good and sleeping good at nights these days. So, you know, the Jets could end up foregoing that label of a real good defensive team and a rotten offensive team and maybe even that thing out or turn it the other way.
Well, they have no excuses now because there are no significant injuries on offense. So they've got the entire offense intact. Again, as a Jet fan, I'd be taking Pittsburgh, and I will. I mean, I take Pittsburgh this week. I mean, the Jets have to prove. Go back to the Minnesota game. I didn't even understand why they were a 2.5-point dog. I mean, that's it? You just lost to Denver. You beat New England. Minnesota beat San Francisco and Houston, and Minnesota's a 2.5-point. So what is all this respect that the Jets are getting with the lines out there? I don't understand.
Aaron Rodgers gets a lot of respect.
Aaron Rodgers, you're right, Jim. Yeah. It's an Aaron Rodgers thing, exactly.
The Jets have to learn or start being able to run the football. They're like down there at the bottom. I think they're like second or third to last as far as rushing yards per game. Now, with Adams, it should open up the passing game more. When if the passing game is opened up, the running game should open up. So let's see if Hall and his backups can do some damage this week. This Jets team is just, I don't know. I'm a longtime Jets fan as well, Greg. And it's
we
paid for it 50 years ago.
It's a can't lose situation as far as I'm concerned, because if they don't make the playoffs, which they probably won't, they're going to find a new coach. And I'm hoping, because I know Woody's going to go after a marquee guy. And I am just hoping that Ben Johnson waited this long for this type of a job, because I would like nothing better than to get that Detroit offensive coordinator over in New York. So
when he brings Bill Cowher in, what will the excuse be then if they don't win?
Bill Cowher.
How about Bill Belichick? But the only thing, instead of signing a napkin, he's actually got to sign some piece of paper.
Yeah, no Bill Belichick.
From that time when he was a
I wouldn't be surprised if they went after Slowick, the coordinator for the Texans, because I think there's a little bit more of a connection there. But either way, like I said, I don't think I could lose, because if they don't do it this year, then they're going to go out and get some.
Well, they're going to have to do something at quarterback. I mean, Aaron Rodgers is not going to be able to hang around much longer. He still looks a little gimpy.
He's showing his age.
Yeah, I mean,
he really is. He's a little bit slower with the release, a little bit slower with the decision making.
I don't think you can depend on him to make it through this year and then make it through another year after this. I don't see that.
Well, you know, if I look like guys like I have a few scabs on me, it's because I've removed all the bandages from last week's beating as underdogs in the National Football League.
0-8.
Oh my God!
Home underdogs were 0-8 last week.
Straight up and against the spread. Yes,
unbelievable.
I don't recall going back that far.
I don't remember results
like that at all. So, you know, my philosophy is I will be first in line at the home underdog window this week, and we'll see whether or not.
Well, I was going to say that given how the underdogs had performed, it was due for regression. It's just that, A, you don't know when it's coming, and B, you certainly don't expect that regression to occur all at once.
Yeah, in that large degree, exactly like this.
I'm going to change sports one second.
Sure.
Greg, I'm not going to talk about WNBA.
Oh, thank you.
I know you hate that. We're going to talk about baseball. Is this some kind of a record
not much better,
the Dodgers are setting? Every game they win, it's a shutout?
For the Dodgers?
Yes.
Well, I know they said that when they had shut out the Padres in winning that series and then starting off with a shutout of the Mets, that was only the third time that there have been three consecutive postseason shutouts. I think one was the Orioles at one point, and I think the other, we had to go back to like 1903 or something with the Giants, and back in those days.
And they did it again last night.
Yeah, well, yeah. So this would be like four straight wins by shutouts, but there were two losses, I think, or one loss in the middle of those games that interrupted that streak.
I mean, and their frontline pitching isn't even there. I mean, they're just doing this with bullpen.
Dave Roberts gets a lot of criticism for a lot of the decisions he makes, but not with the way he's managing the bullpen.
Absolutely.
in the playoffs.
Are there a lot of strikeouts? Is that what's still going on?
I mean, Buehler got out of trouble and in and out of trouble the other day. The other, one of the shutouts was a big bullpen renaissance, but it was about, what, five, six guys that ended up pitching. So it's been kind of a smorgasbord. One of the Yoshi threw one. Flaherty went deep in game one of the NLCS. So
Roberts actually did a smart thing. I've always, you know, I don't really care for these bullpen games. I went back, and in fact, I think Jim, you might remember this in the early 1990s when La Russa was coaching the A's. He would have pitchers pitch like three innings and then bring in a reliever, three innings and a reliever. I've not argued with that approach, but what I would have done, and Roberts sort of did this last night to a different degree, is you get a starting pitcher, he goes through the lineup once. As soon as he's faced that ninth batter, you bring in a reliever. And if you can do it righty-lefty, et cetera, it's even better. You never get to see the same pitcher twice, and if you do it righty lefty, etc., you never get to see the same right hand or left hand twice when it, you're at bat. So you're going from, you know, one extreme to the other. Now what he did last night, as soon as Walker Buehler got through the lineup the second time, he got pulled. They did not let him face the leadoff batter for a third time. That I thought was very smart, because he has struggled, and now you start hearing the announcers and all the stat guys coming up with, you know, this pitcher is really good early, but the third time through the lineup, they're hitting like 350 or whatever against him. So there's a lot of merit to going through the lineup once, no more than twice, and then making a change. The game has changed. Starting pitching is no longer the important thing. In fact, I've always felt that, you know, they had the rule where a starter had to go at least five innings. I think these days you have to basically say that if you're going to credit a pitcher with a win, which I think is silly anyway, give it to the guy who over the course of the nine innings or the extra innings was the most effective.
Is this just something in the sport, though, that you think we're going through? Or do you believe, I mean, really, well, let's just fast forward to 20, 30 years from now. How do you see the pitching staffs? Do you think it's going to be more like this, or do you think it's going to revert back to pitchers being able to pitch six, seven, eight, nine innings a game?
I think it's going to be more like this.
Because of the Tommy John issue and the elbows and all that, I don't think we're going backwards.
Also, the other thing is we can go back 20 or 30 years when closers first came into vogue, and you know they've actually increased, and in fact, they've now come in with seventh and eighth inning specialists. So the game
middle guys. Yeah.
Exactly, continuing to evolve. And most sports are cyclical. Baseball seems not to be cyclical.
I wonder whether or not that, because it always starts at the bottom. It starts at the lower levels and how you teach these kids and groom them to become pitchers in the big leagues. I just wonder whether or not they're going to realize over time that, look, you just can't go out there and throw five or six innings of 98 miles an hour. It's not going to work. We've got to figure out a way to stretch these arms out, or the mental part. We got to learn to focus on throwing consistently 90 to 93 instead of 99. And that 90 to 93 will get us to go six, seven, eight innings. Because I just don't think the sport is going to succeed for the long haul if people are going to be looking at bullpen by committees.
I watched the Cleveland Indians bring this bullpen, you know, of theirs in, and they're all like 6'4", and they all throw like 99 miles an hour.
Oh, yeah.
It's like one after another. It's like, oh, my goodness. But, Andy, you bring out a real good point in that how cyclical baseball can be and how things can change and evolve as they are. I can remember back when there weren't bullpens or there weren't closers. The Cleveland Indians in my day, because I grew up there, I think they were the first team that really was recognized as having a bullpen. They had Don Mossy and Ray Narleski behind early winning that.
Mr. Ears. Don Mossy.
Exactly. Well, that was at the advent of bullpens per se. And now what they've done with those bullpens is they've turned them into starters, and they're tweaking it always and forever. And I being a, when I handicap baseball, the first thing I handicap are the starting pitchers, and I get disappointed more often than not when I look and see a bullpen pitcher is starting a game.
I think it's been about 5 or 6 years. I think Joe Maddon started that in Tampa Bay, and we've seen gradually over the last few years, and maybe even at an increased pace the last year or two, more and more managers going to the starter deliberately and have him pitch maybe one inning, an inning and a third or so, and then going into the next relievers. And so, Greg, to answer your question, the evolution may actually be, you talked about guys going out there, you can't throw four or five innings, 98 miles per hour, but you can't throw an inning or two. Yeah. And we may end up seeing more recruiting and developing of pitchers. Hey, give us what you got. Maybe you'll throw 30 pitchers, and it's on to the next guy who can throw 30 pitchers at 98 plus. And that way, pitchers will go every 2 or 3 days.
I do think that's where we're going.
But I think if you get like one of those, again, you got to look for, obviously, I think it starts with the father who grooms the son and says, all right, you know, I'm gonna make you a star, and this is how we're going to do it. And maybe that's the guy that's going to change things. Like I said, maybe that pitcher is going to go out there and he's going to throw 90-93, and he's going to be able to throw eight innings. And I like that. I'm going to give this guy a really big contract because that's the rarity. And then you pick up on it. Because like I said, I just can't think 30, 40 years from now that everybody's looking at a bullpen by committee. I don't think it's going to work. I do have to ask you guys before we turn around and talk football, one last thing, and that is, did you feel the game actually has been faster as far as all the rules that have been implemented this season?
Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah, it has moved at a faster pace. There's some things about it that, as a baseball purist, you don't like putting base runners on second base and extra innings and things like that. To me, that's softball. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Those are things you do, but nonetheless, it has moved the pace.
The pitch clock has made a big difference.
Yeah.
It has.
I wonder if a guy like Greg Maddux would be used today. He never had 95, 98 miles, but he had outstanding control. He had in the ERAs at the peak of his career, his ERAs were like 2.2 and lower, and he would go 7-8 innings before bringing in a reliever. I wonder if a guy like that would even be given a chance to display that talent today.
Well, I think he'd be given a chance.
Maybe we'll find out with Paul Skenes.
I think he would. Well, I think he'd be getting a big contract.
He was an exception. I mean, nobody could hit him. I mean, it was the tremendous accuracy, control of his pitches.
Yeah, pinpoint control. Exactly.
Yeah, he was incredible.
But all right, guys. Jim, you didn't realize it when you said, let me throw some baseball out there. We didn't know where it was going, but it went a long way.
Maybe the listeners would have.
A couple weeks ago, I got off on a tangent on the WNBA, and Greg eliminated the whole spot from the show. So I can't talk about that anymore.
I was just going to say that with all our talk of baseball the last 10, 15 minutes, maybe the viewers and listeners wished we had started NBA because we couldn't have gone that long.
I can't watch anything I'm on unless there's a reason to, so I had no idea about that, Jim. And that really saddens me now.
Yeah, I know. We were reaching out across. I watched the show and it wasn't even there.
Good Lord, De Palma, come on.
Now, we could end up teasing the audience. We could tease the audience and say, that was actually the best part of the show that week.
Yeah,
that
you didn't.
And nobody saw it.
You never saw it. Well, guys, what you haven't seen here today is the Playbook Football Newsletter. We were in a little bit of a delay funk again. We're having collateral damage, if you will, issues because of the hurricanes. And again, we had power out, no internet, so forth and whatnot, from our newsletter crew in North Carolina. So we were out and delayed a little bit. It finally came out today on Thursday as we're talking. And if you download this week's newsletter, it's really, really filled with some good information. I'll throw a couple of teasers out at you. There's in college football, how about an underdog that has beat the opponent they're playing 22 years in a row? They're the underdog in the game.
Oh, I know that one is. That's one of my favorite picks of the week. I actually have him in the wise guy contest.
Well, don't blow it, Greg. But there is somebody like that. Let the readers identify exactly who that is.
Yeah.
That's kind of it. I call it dia, dominating dogs in action, doing it again.
And that actually, it's interesting. Wow. There's another dog, and this is where I originally went until you said 22 years in a row. There's another underdog this week, however, that has lost like 8-10 out of 19 against this week's opponent.
But he's an underdog or he's a favorite?
It's an underdog this week.
Well, would an underdog maybe not be so surprising that he's lost 18 out of 19 times? I mean,
it's a quality team.
Oh, a quality team. Wow.
Very, very quality team.
Wow. You can find that out in Andy Isco's newsletter, The Logical Approach.
I don't think I wrote about that one in there.
Oh, come on.
Well, then tell us.
If I'm correct, hasn't Alabama beaten Tennessee like 18 out of 19 or 17 out of 18? The exception being that, 55-49 game a few years ago?
Well, they beat him 16 of the last 17 is what they beat him.
That's what it is. Yeah. That other one was that very entertaining game a few years ago. I think, what was it? Holder was the quarterback for Tennessee that year.
Who was that?
The Tennessee and Alabama.
Oh, yeah. That was a great game. Yeah, they're back. The Detroit draft pick. Yeah, he was the quarterback.
Yeah.
Yep.
Hey, guys, getting back to the newsletter, inside the newsletter, NFL side of things. There's a team out there that's 0-13 to the spread in their next game after taking on a certain division rival who they just played last week. They're in that role this week, 0-13 in the follow-up.
Wow.
And a quarterback in a role in which he is 14-1 against the spread in his NFL career. and he's in that role this particular week as well. You can check.
I'll mention about that one about the division rival and all that. It might have been worse, except there were a couple of seasons where it couldn't come into play because they ended the season playing each other.
Well, that's true. So it didn't count in that sense. But
yeah,
anyway,
it didn't come into play.
Exactly right. You can check it out all online at playbooksports.com. Download the newsletter just in time for the weekend. And if you would, hit the like button down below or subscribe. We'd love to have you subscribe. Our goal is to get 1,000 subscribers on the show. We're getting a big, big boost in our viewers each week, and we'd love to raise that subscriber total. So hit the like button and subscribe to the show if you will. Andy, before we turn it over to the panel for a discussion here, I want to bring up the Survivor contest again. We talked about it last week. Last week, there were 227 live entries. There's 221 this week. Only 6 people got bumped out last week, meaning it was kind of chalky, and that's sort of what the results of the National Football League were really, really chalky. But we've also got now an implied current value of $64,552 for each of those 221 entries. So
I think it's up a little bit because I think that was the number last week when there were 221 remaining, or 227 remaining. I think it was 64. I think it's up to about 67 now because I think there were 6 eliminated. I forget who the most who the teams were because I know that trying to remember who the most popular team was last year. Maybe it was last week. I don't recall. I can check that at some point during the show. But it's the first week where we haven't had a huge turnover in the field. And in fact, there's another contest in town, a lower end contest at one of the local properties, Last Man Standing. They have one for college and one for the pros. That involves the point spread, so you can pick a team as often as you want. They started with, I think, 3,700 entries or so. They're down to 94, so a lot of carnage has been done. I didn't set to see I'll be interested to see what there are a lot of very competitive games this week. I think the most well-balanced game this week in that kind of contest, you might see Minnesota-Detroit be very close, evenly split. Those are two teams that it's hard to find anything negative about either of them, and you've got many more positives for both of those teams.
The only thing negative I can find, Andy, and we're not going to that game, so I might throw a little bit about what I saw into the game, is that if you look at the body of work for the Minnesota Vikings, and they're coming back with the week of rest coming back from London, but if you look at their undefeated record, the last 3 games they've been out-yarded by every opponent they've played. That's sort of, to me, a cotter pin that's beginning to slip. And that stuff eventually always comes back and bites you. It's a sign that there's something not quite right. These teams are not hitting on the cylinders that they appear to be. So see if that doesn't happen to the Minnesota Vikings this week when they play Detroit. Just my 2 cents on that.
No, it makes a lot of sense. And in fact, if you want to take a look along the same lines for Detroit, they've gained a lot of yards this year, but they haven't in many instances been able to convert those yards into points. So there's another team that's dominated the stats. You know, what was it, the game against Tampa Bay? I think they had like a 2-1 yardage advantage, and they put up, 16 points in the loss to Tampa Bay. And I think they had a similar lack of productivity in cashing in yardage in the win against Arizona a week later.
Well, Andy,
they do control the clock a lot with their running game because there's such a tremendous running game, offensive line, et cetera. So that might be the reason because it's not as explosive scoring-wise, but they do control the game with that running game.
And keep in mind, too, this is now a spot that Minnesota has not been good at. They're the home favorite now. They were the dog against San Francisco. They were the dog against Houston. And now they're in a role that they haven't been very good at. It's also a very good role for Dan Campbell. I mean, Dan Campbell.
What is the loss of Hutchinson?
It could be huge.
You can't replace a player like that.
We're already down at DE, too.
It's massive. Or the point spread value to.
Well, I would think he's at least 2 points. You know, quarterbacks can be more, but he may be 2. But I don't see it in that this line is what it was. I think even before it was announced that he was out for the year, or it could have been like this because they knew he was out for the year.
And I also heard that they're looking to, I forget who the trade partner was, but they are looking to bolster the position before the deadline with the expectation that we heard that Hutchinson might be able to return late in the playoffs if all goes well. But usually when they say those kind of things, don't expect it to happen. So I think the Lions are looking to find a longer term solution for this season.
Well, there's only one guy that really sticks out, and that's Reddick.
Yeah, that's, I think, the team. The Jets, I heard, was the team that they were looking at.
But, if the Raiders want to have a fire sale, Max Crosby can go back.
No way. They're never getting rid of Crosby. No way.
Well, he did go to, what was it, Eastern Michigan?
Yeah,
it would be like a homecoming there. But the Raiders have said there's no truth to that, which probably means they're talking.
Yeah, that's what I would think. I told you guys, if you watch Netflix's receiver, this Aaron Rodgers, Devontae Adams thing, you don't have I like all you guys. I wouldn't sit down with you for 6 hours at dinner and sit there and come out with a bro hug and say, I'll see you next time. I mean, that was quite the prescient moment in that series. I think that was the biggest takeaway from the Devontae Adams portion of it. And what 6 weeks after it aired, he's a Jet.
Yes,
I wonder how effective it'll be this for. I think it will help the Jets. It might not help this week, however. It may take some time for them to get their timing back. It's been a number of years since they have played together, and you know, we've already talked about Rodgers slowing down a little bit. And you know, I'm guessing the hamstring injury was probably fully healed a few weeks ago, but the Raiders knew they were going to make the trade, and they didn't want to risk trading a player who might be able to get re-injured and decrease the value of what they got.
Andy, how real do you think that hamstring injury was? I mean, is it coincidental that it healed up just the day he got traded and he's starting?
No, that's what I'm saying. I think it was probably healed, but the Raiders knew they were going to make a trade, and they didn't want to risk further injury or a re-aggravation of the injury. And perhaps, the thing is, he passed the Jets physical, so I guess all is okay.
So he hauled in $1.5 million for each game that he missed, nursing that sore hamstring. It's, I guess, sort of a tough luck thing for him to have to take in only $1.5 million for every game that you don't play. But yeah. That's what life is in the National Football League.
Oh my God. Yeah.
Hey, guys, let's get over to our college football side of things here. And we're going to tear down a pretty big football game. And Andy alluded to it earlier, Alabama-Tennessee inside the Southeast Conference. It's more or less a game that each of these two teams needs to stay alive in the SEC chase, if you will, if they want to play in that SEC championship game. Each have one loss in the football season here. I'm going to start out with you, Andy, and your take here on Alabama-Tennessee playing this week. I know we mentioned before, Bama has beat them 16 of the last 17 times.
It's interesting because both teams are struggling right now, but on different sides of the football. Alabama's defense has not looked very good the last few weeks, certainly starting with that loss to Georgia, which they had a big lead. They gave it up and came back to win on the next play. And for Tennessee, the offense has been down the last couple of weeks against first Arkansas, the game they lost, and then last week when they won in overtime but allowed a late touchdown for the game to Florida in order for the game to get to overtime. I believe Mertz was already injured when they scored that tying touchdown, if I recall correctly. So you've got two teams that are playing well on one side of the ball. Alabama's offense has been fine, and Tennessee's defense has been fine. So I'm not quite sure which one will take advantage of the other. But you point out correctly, they both got one loss. Most likely, the SEC is expected to get three or four teams. However, they'll probably go to teams with one losses before they take an Alabama two-loss team or a Tennessee two-loss team. So that does make that. That's one of the good things about this playoff. There are more meaningful late-season, regular-season games because teams will be trying to avoid that disqualifying loss. It was a lot tougher remain active with a disqualifying loss when there are only four teams in the playoffs. Now there are basically 11 plus the at-large team. I do like Alabama. I like the way Milroe continued to play all year. Again, you don't have Nick Saban on the sideline for Alabama, and maybe the coaching was an impact to why they struggled last week following the loss to Georgia in the game against South Carolina. So I probably would prefer to go with Alabama in the game, but for anyone who wants to make a case on Tennessee, plus the 2.5 and certainly plus the 3, I'd be hard-pressed to talk them out of it.
I agree with you, Andy. We mentioned Alabama's dominance in the series. You can also look at the other side of the coin and say that Tennessee has won 19 of the last 20 home games at Neyland Stadium. They don't lose with regularity there at all. And if you take a look at their body of work this year, in their games, they're plus 292 net yards per game in the stats. They win the stats by almost 300 yards a game. Does Tennessee, this 3-point home dog this week, which makes them, I think, a real live home dog. And you break down the numbers from our midweek alert, our statistical newsletter, we see Alabama with the number 35 offense, the number 51 defense. Those numbers are a little bit short of what Nick Saban's teams had put up in the past, 35 and 51. And Tennessee counters us with the number 9 offense and the number 6 defense. So they rank in the top 10 offensively and defensively. which means Tennessee then becomes what I call a bod, a dog with a better offense and the better defense. That's my take going into the game here. Tony, how do you see this game shaping up?
I mean, look, I was I think I picked Nico Iemanjiava to be my Heisman guy when we were doing that. So I was surprised as early as the Oklahoma game, because he cruised through the first few games, by how timid he looked. Didn't look like he was looking to run the ball, so I don't know if there's anything physical. And certainly his passing has been an issue, his accuracy. And then you have the lack of separation from their wide receivers, which are supposed to be a strength, and has turned into a weakness. So it has not been coincidental. And you know, we talk about how there are no coincidences, that this defense, this offense has really hit the skids over the last few weeks. And then I respect Kane Womack as a defensive mind. So it's puzzling that Alabama's defense has been as poor as they have been. I mean, they gave up 25 points to a really simple South Carolina offense. I mean, it's a freshman quarterback. It's a team that has, for the most part, struggled and was expected to, because they did lose Leggett to the NFL. He's playing with the Panthers now. Caught a touchdown pass just last week, and so it's a South Carolina offense. They shouldn't have done what they did to where they could have tied that game with a 2-point conversion, then come up with the onside kick. Yeah, had their chance to actually stun South Alabama. So, I mean, you look at a team that has now given up 92 points over their last 10 quarters after taking that huge lead over Georgia. So can Tennessee take advantage of this defense that suddenly looks vulnerable? If Nico plays well, I think they can, but I just haven't seen it. I mean, they basically got a run game, and they'll have the home field advantage. I'm still riding Alabama. Too much talent. I'll trust Milroe, but Milroe four interceptions over the last three games. So that's not something we come to expect. So I think Andy said it very well, that these are two teams whose strengths have suddenly turned into question marks. So, I don't think that has a bearing for me on the point spread. I think the right team is favored, and I would go Crimson Tide money line. But
I don't talk too much about college, but when you – I know it's a short season, so you – the numbers aren't really there when you're only playing 11, 12 games, but strength of schedule, how much do you look at that when you're comparing these kind of teams?
I mean, teams at this level, you're playing scrimmages for the most part until you're really tested. But I mean, if you're talking Alabama, they should have done more against South Florida, really struggled until that, the very end. I mean, that was a fourth quarter game where the Bulls had a chance to win. You have the South Carolina game. That's a blowout that turns into not being a blowout. It's a 2-point game. And then obviously you lose to Vanderbilt. So from a strength of schedule standpoint, I think Tennessee has played a tougher schedule. They obliterated NC State back when NC State, although, I mean, they had the quarterback issue because McCall was hurt. But beyond that, you have the Vols really playing an Oklahoma team that hasn't turned into much offensively, and that was a defensive grinder game. So we expect the Tennessee to be one of the most prolific offenses in the country, and they just haven't been.
The only thing I'll mention about strength of schedule is that two of Tennessee's games were against Tennessee Chattanooga, who they blew out, and Kent State, which is almost the same as a Tennessee Chattanooga, even though they're an FBS team. They also played, as Tony pointed out, NC State, Oklahoma, and Arkansas, and Florida. Alabama has not played an FCS team. Western Kentucky, South Florida, Wisconsin, who's improving, Georgia, who we know is very good, and a Vanderbilt team, who they lost to, of course, is a team that's better than we expected, in South Carolina. So I would give the edge. One of the things I do, and I don't have it in front of me, is when I look at my stats or I write about the stats, I eliminate games against FCS teams. So I have stats on what Tennessee looks like without the game against Chattanooga in there. Still very impressive, not quite as impressive as the stats with them included, which are the stats that we normally see published in the various websites and newspapers, etc. But I would certainly, if you asked me who played the tougher schedule, I'd have to say it was Alabama, largely because not just Chattanooga, but Kent State's one of the bottom teams in the FBS.
Tony, I gotta tell you this, that when I was working on the Playbook Football Preview Guide magazine in the offseason, and we're doing the teams, and there wasn't a lot of information to be had out there, so you had to do a lot of scratching and clawing. And I come into the Tennessee side and look at the quarterback, and I really did never heard how his name was pronounced. And just phonetically, the way it looked, it looks like I'm a Leva. And I thought,
I'm a Leva.
Yeah. How apropos for the college transfer portal, a quarterback, I'm a Leva. But that's not the way it's pronounced, but nonetheless.
That's not the song that the Monkees sang. That was I'm a Believer.
I'm a Believer.
That's close.
Yes.
It's close.
Exactly. Greg DePalma, how do you see this game, Alabama-Tennessee? A lot of intrigue in the football game. Do you think there's an edge to either side?
Well, I think it's definitely Alabama's got the edge because, as you've mentioned a few times, I mean, they've been the dominant program in the series. I definitely think that goes a long way. And you have to consider, as we mentioned, it was such a great game. It was such a great win for Tennessee. I mean, just look at what they had to do to finally break through and beat Alabama. I mean, they had to have, like, everything. I mean, they had, like, they were the hottest that they have been as a program in years. And they had a hot quarterback. And it was just a great game. And I don't know if I can see that happening again. I know that this kid's a talented one, but he's still a little bit young. And just take a look at the way Tennessee's season has gone. They get off to a great start, but really the last few games, I mean, you take a look at the Oklahoma game, and now, I mean, you know, Oklahoma, it's just not very good. And then look what happened in the Florida game. And we talked about this last week, Mark. That was one of our upset picks. You picked that. On the show that we do at the Our Lads Football Channel, I come up with some upset opportunities and I give like three or four of them and I ask you to pick your favorite, and you said Florida was your favorite in the group. And honestly, if Graham Mertz would have been healthy the rest of the game, I think they win the game. And that goes to overtime. So I think Tennessee's reeling a little bit. I know Alabama struggled against South Carolina. They needed a 2-point stop late, and I get that. But I honestly think that's just the way college football is nowadays. That's another big storyline, too, that I think that we need to keep an eye on in college football, is that I think that the days are going to be over as far as, you know, three straight wins, national championship, dominant team. They go three deep. I don't think that's happening anymore. Look, Georgia had a tough game against Mississippi State. I mean, I just think that we're going to see a lot more parity now in college football. And so I think Alabama in that close win, I'm not going to give them bad marks for it. It came the week after that they had the big Georgia win. So I think they're going to be revved up, and I think they're going to be ready to go. And I just think they're a better team than Tennessee. And by the way, keep an eye on the fact that Tennessee lost their number one tackler and their team captain on defense, the linebacker. He's out for the season, so that's going to be a big loss for the Vols as well. So I'm going to agree with Tony, and I'm taking Alabama.
Well, Greg, you mentioned Georgia last year going for that inevitable three-peat. Our NFL football game of the year finds an NFL football team going for the three-peat. We're going to preview the Kansas City-San Francisco 49ers game. And Jim Feist, the first question I want to ask you, Kansas City, San Francisco, Kansas City undefeated. Can Kansas City, or will Kansas City, three-peat this year?
Oh, boy. Do you have any easier questions?
I said can. You said sure they can, but the question is will they?
I'm going to go back to my analysis of the Super Bowl last year. I'm going to stick with this. They have an excellent quarterback. They have an excellent offensive and defensive scheme. They got a defensive coordinator that might be the best in the business, and he's at least rated one or two in the business as a defensive coordinator, Spagnuolo. And then, of course, Andy Reid, who's done a remarkable job with Kansas City. You go back to his Philadelphia days, he took that team to a lot of big games as well. This team is well coached. Now, as far as the AFC, I don't see a challenger coming out of the AFC East. I mean, where's the challenger going to come from? And if this team puts together, I know they've had another year of bad luck at the wide receiver position. And it seems like Mahomes is not 100% comfortable behind his offensive line. He seems to dump the ball off a lot quicker than maybe he should at times because they're not showing the protection. Kelsey still can play. Yeah, they sat him down for a little bit because he's spending too much time with Swifty, but that's okay. He can still play. He's still pretty damn good. Yeah, they can repeat. And I thought in the beginning of the year that they would be there at the end and most likely would be in the Super Bowl. But when you look at the other side, you got to go to the NFC and start looking at some of those teams. And the NFC's got some pretty damn good teams, including the one they're playing this week, who happens to be hurt. They're still down CMC and all that. But, you know, then you got to look at Detroit, and you got to look at Green Bay, and you got to look at Minnesota. And you're certainly not going to look at Philadelphia or Dallas anymore because neither one are playing very well. Washington may win the NFC East, but they're not going to do it with that defense. They're not going to go far. So, yes, they could repeat because I think there's not enough depth of talent in the AFC to keep them out of the Super Bowl. It's very, very possible they could repeat.
So your answer is, will they? I know you're saying it's possible they can. If you're betting yes or no, what are you betting?
No.
No.
Because there's too many challenges along the way. And the reason is, I don't bet futures because they don't give you a fair value. If they would give you fair value, then I would make a futures bet that would tie up my money if you were playing hard cash instead of on credit. I do play on credit, so it's not an issue. But for most people, they got to tie up hard dollars to go. And then you're dealing with injuries, what's going to happen, what could happen. Futures bets have got to offer more value, expected value for me to tie up money. So I don't make those kind of bets. Verbally, I would say they have a good chance of getting out of the AFC and making it that far.
Andy Isco, big question here in this football game. The obvious, will Super Bowl revenge be a factor in this football game? I know if you look at it, that's the first thing the announcers are going to talk about, the public's going to read about. That's all we're going to hear about, Super Bowl revenge. Is it a real factor handicapping this football game?
Hard to say, but I would say probably not. Certainly not in the results. I'm going back and looking at, including the Super Bowls. Kansas City has won 4 straight and 6 out of the last 7 meetings. And the 7th meeting goes all the way back in 2006. Now, they play each other every 4 years in the regular season, but they play whenever they happen to meet, of course, in the Super Bowl. So they've won 4 straight. In fact, 6 out of 7 straight up. And that's before Andy Reid and Shanahan are there, many of those games. But they're also 6-0-1 against the point spread versus Kansas City. Now, 2 of those, of course, were in Super Bowls. No McCaffrey. I think that hurts San Francisco, and we don't know about the backup if he's fully healthy. And Kansas City just plays with confidence. We know how Andy Reid does historically with Philadelphia and now with Kansas City coming off of a bye week. I think we've seen certainly the last three times that they've met, both have been the coaches. So we certainly have seen Andy Reid have the edge over Shanahan. And, of course, we all remember Shanahan from his days in Atlanta with that Super Bowl against New England. So I have to give a huge coaching edge to Kansas City. And now you get the fact that they're coming off a bye. It's on the road, but that hasn't stopped them in the past from winning, whether it be road or neutral site. So I've got a lot of edges on Kansas City. So I don't know if I'll play it, but if I do, it'll be Kansas City.
Andy Isco leaning to Kansas City on the money line. Tony Mejia, big game, San Francisco, Kansas City. How do you see it shaking out?
Well, Jordan Mason is probably going to play, but when I looked at this game, it looked like he might not. So if he doesn't, obviously no McCaffrey, and no Jordan Mason would leave the 49ers with some question marks in the backfield. Isaac Garendo, the rookie, who pissed off bettors that had him by pulling up right before the goal line, and they scored a touchdown anyway. He pissed off their fantasy owners. He would probably get the call. They also have Patrick Taylor, who's a little more battle-tested over the years, but he's still young. So, you have guys that aren't probably as efficient and proficient in picking up blitzes and whatnot, and obviously that's a huge part of dealing with the Steve Spagnuolo defense. So from that standpoint, I like Kansas City a little more than I would if Mason is a go, and we won't know that until, probably day of, morning of. But I think the Kansas City run game is also interesting. without Edwards-Helaire all season, and then obviously losing their top back pretty early. It's been the Kareem Hunt show. He had 27 carries last week. So clearly Andy Reid wants to continue to run the ball. I saw somebody tweet out that Brock Purdy is playing better than Patrick Mahomes this season. Will that matter? And I'm not really sure I agree with that. I mean, Purdy's had his ups and downs, and Mahomes is Mahomes. So I think this is probably going to be a four-quarter game. We see Mahomes just in February take a team and put him on his back and through rushes extend that game on fourth downs. So he'll pull out whatever it takes to win this game. I think it's a slightly bigger game than any other regular season game, even though we're just in week seven. I think if I had a player prop to give out in it, and I did this for Sporting News, I would like Kareem Hunt to get in the end zone. I think he did it last week, and then Andy Reid probably trusts him a little more than Steele, who was envisioned to be the goal line back, but once he fumbled, he's had that role diminish a lot more. So, I would lean towards Kansas City, especially if you're going to give me points, and definitely if Mason doesn't play.
Tony Mejia toward the Kansas City Chiefs in this football game. I'm going to take a little bit of a different look at the game, at least maybe from a statistical standpoint. We all talk about Andy Reid and how well he's done with rest. Everybody know 22-4 straight up his last 26 games off a bye week, which is really, really good. But break him down a little deeper, guys. The last seven times Reid has had a week of rest, he's only gone 2-5 to the spread in those football games, which tells me it gets priced for when Andy Reid is coming off a bye. It's so popular. And usually his teams are good, so the combination of the two, you got to pay a tariff, if you will, to back Kansas City with rest coming into a football game. The Chiefs have been unbelievably good as a road dog, 15-1 to the spread the last 16 games. Kansas City on the road taking points. Really, really difficult to pass up a number like this. San Francisco, you talked about Kyle Shanahan. He's been really good at home with a 500 or better record against undefeated teams. He's 6-1-1 to the spread in his career. But when you look at these teams this year, how they shake it out offensively and defensively, statistically, you're talking about a San Francisco team that's number 2 overall in offense, number 11 overall in defense. Kansas City, number 11 offense and number 9 defense. So the checkbox go more towards San Francisco here than they do Kansas City, at least from a statistical standpoint. So what does it all mean? Does it mean that San Francisco gets their Super Bowl revenge this particular week? I think they do. Only because you got an undefeated Super Bowl defending champion here who is not going to stay undefeated all season long. We know that. And if he does take that first loss, where is the most logical choice that's going to come? Probably at a venue like San Francisco with a team on a chip on its shoulder here. So put me down for the 49ers in this football game.
Who's the advantage in field goal kicking?
Who's the advantage in field goal kicking?
Chiefs.
Probably Butker, right, would you say?
Probably. Well, we had an issue a couple weeks ago where San Francisco didn't even have a kicker anymore.
Yes.
So, I mean, that might be that close that it comes down to that.
Or who would you rather have at quarterback if you're down by 2 points and it's 4 minutes to go in the fourth quarter? Between the two quarterbacks. Now, we don't know what would happen, but I'm saying that has to be considered an edge for Kansas City.
You mentioned quarterbacks, Andy, and I'm going to share this with you guys and our listeners out there. I was listening to an interview with Jerry Rice, the San Francisco great, and they were asking him about quarterbacks, Joe Montana, how they deliver the ball, accuracy, how crisp, how fast, deliberate. And he said he is absolutely stunned and surprised at how pinpoint accurate and how the velocity that he has in the ball for Brock Purdy. He says it's unbelievable. He says you would never know that this kid almost never got drafted, because if you catch his passes like I did, he said you'd insist this kid's a first-round quarterback. So maybe they did their work on him, or he fell into their lap, one or the other. But basically what Jerry Rice was saying is Purdy is the real deal, at least as far as delivering the football is from a quarterback standpoint.
And that's a lot to do with John Lynch and the way that he has built this team up since he became general manager. He's one of the few ex-players who has excelled in the role of executive. Probably the other one that comes to mind immediately is Ozzie Newsome.
Yes.
And what he did with the Ravens for so many years.
Exactly. Ex-Cleveland Brown, when they made that move to Baltimore, Ozzie went with him, and so did all the Cleveland fortunes, and the Baltimore success followed along with all of that. Greg DePalma, if you will, you do us the honors here. I know you would like to take us around the horn and ask us about some of the best bets or trends or facts and stats that we have on our card this week. Before I hand it off to you, I want to let our listeners know that the Playbook Totals tip sheet, Victor's Pride and Joy, had a great week last week. He was 4-1 on his best bets last week. That's the same Totals tip sheet that has won 14 of the last 17 years. You'll want to download this week's Totals tip sheet just in time for the NFL football games, and you can do it online at playbooksports.com. Greg, with that, I'm going to hand it over to you for our high five segment.
All right. And you, by the way, you mentioned Kansas City being, what was the number, Mark? 14-1, 15-1, I believe, as a road dog in
yes.
the last 16. Well, I just double checked because I remember having this. They have actually covered 14 straight as a road dog. So not only that, but it's 14 straight. And by the way, even more impressively, they've won 12 of them outright. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that before.
That's what Super Bowl winning teams do, Greg.
Absolutely. Yep. Especially a team that's trying to win three Super Bowls in a row, which hasn't happened. You're absolutely right.
The thing that's surprising is that Kansas City's been an underdog that often since they really be. Well, I mean, look, their run started when Mahomes, what was it, 2018, his first year as a full-time starter? So we're talking 6-7 years now. That's a surprising number of times for a team that good and has accomplished as much as they have. Remember, they also lost a Super Bowl during this period of time as well, that they're an underdog that often. And, you know, the fact that they've won more than 50% of those games shows that sometimes the lines makers don't get it right as far as what team should be favored when you're looking at a team that's accomplished as much as Kansas City has.
Good point, Andy. Real good.
And all right, I was Greg. Able to get the same information on that trend for Kansas City as Mark because I purchased a Playbook preseason preview Playbook guide.
I bet you didn't even buy it. I'll bet you somebody gave you that book.
Yeah, I think you're right about that. So I would have bought it, though. So there you go. Let's now get into each one of our handicappers' shorts of the week. And again, if you wind up missing one of these shows, don't worry because I'll be able to edit and put these shorts available on the channel, so you can check that out. That's why you want to subscribe to the channel, of course, as well, in case you, for some reason, you missed the show. You can always check out the shorts and get each one of our handicappers top plays or just a minute of what they want to talk about on any particular week in college football and the NFL. We're going to start this week with Tony. Tony, you're up first, so let me know when you're ready to go, and I'll start the one-minute timer.
One second to look up one thing.
Yeah, you see, he thought I was going to go to Andy. Probably.
You're being penalized, Tony.
Yeah.
You know he's doing it.
Well, I mean, it was a very quick thing, so I'd be ready right now, but whatever
you want. All right, there you go. You are now on the clock, Tony.
It is going to be a beautiful day, which is what I had to check, in Columbia, South Carolina, Columbia, Missouri, I apologize, as Mizzou welcomes in Auburn for a battle of Tigers, and it is game where Auburn comes in off of a bye, and that's significant because Hugh Freeze has been pretty good off a bye, 15-6 in his career as a head coach, and he's got a lot of talent to work with, but it hasn't really coalesced thus far. Auburn's 2-4. He's thrown Peyton Thorne under the bus. He's thrown the backup quarterback under the bus, but I think they'll get some production in this week's game. They've got a lot of talent at receiver, very young, bunch of true freshmen. They've got a transfer in there that's playing very well. So I think Missouri and Auburn ends up a shootout. The total is set at 50. Mizzou has the number one wide receiver in the country in Luther Burden. He's good to go. Dealt with a shoulder injury, but they come off a UMass game where they got to rest a lot of players. So everybody good to go for Mizzou. Look for it to be a one possession game. Team that has the ball last wins. Over is the play, over 50.
All right, Tony, a few seconds over, but I know exactly where I'm going to edit that. So excellent job. I don't usually do totals, but I did. I was going over one of the games this week, Mark, and I said to myself, man, this number has got to be huge. It's got to be the biggest number of the week in college football. That's the New Mexico-Utah State game. I was like, it has to be. I mean, if it, and I don't like betting totals. I'm not a total guy like Victor. But if I was ever going to bet a total like in any way this week, I'd be going, come on, it's got to be like in the 60s or maybe even the 70s. That's how high scoring that game should be. So
I think it's 77 or 76.
Is it really 77? Yeah. Wow,
okay. And very high. And if you've seen those two defenses not play, that might still be too low.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's very reasonable.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And they got good offenses, too, for their level. So, all right. Hey, Bronco Mendenhall getting the Lobos going. We like to see that. All right. Let's now go to Jim. Are you ready, Jim?
I get penalized even before this thing starts. I know, because of the WNBA thing I did. I'm gonna give a coaching advantage here. Who's the better coach, LA Rams against Las Vegas? I'm gonna go with the coach. Who's the better quarterback, LA Rams against Las Vegas? And we might get Cooper Kupp back. This is a mismatch. And Vegas, I think, is deteriorating, which they should for a couple of years until they build that thing up and maybe get an owner that knows what the hell he's doing, which I don't think this guy does. And a coach that can actually coach. I like the LA Rams, but I'm going to give you a second play, and this is just a freebie so he can penalize me because I don't want to go away without my penalty. I'm going with the Green Bay Packers. I got an indoor team coming up for warm weather up into Green Bay. You could get a little bit of weather, and they're absent one of their wide receivers there. I like Green Bay. I like the way Green Bay's coming back, and they got their quarterback back. I think that game is too short. 2.5 points, it's not enough.
Oh, that was perfect, Jim. Perfect.
No.
58 seconds.
I didn't get penalized?
No penalty.
I gotta stop.
And you get a cherry on top.
I got to do it over.
No.
Did he really only do 58 seconds? That sounded like 3 minutes to me.
Yeah, that sounded like 3 minutes to me, too.
I don't know. I think that's a good thing when you can turn.
They're ganging up on me.
Yeah, that's a good thing. All right. Let's now go to Mark.
Okay, let's take a look at an inevitable in college football. And inevitable happens when there are letdowns involved in football games. When teams climb a mountain, they make the trip successfully, and then they have to come back and try and climb another mountain. I don't think it'll happen with Oregon this week. Somebody asked me, will Oregon let down this week? And my answer was, how can they not after the big upset over Ohio State last week? They're going to go out and lay a ton on the road against Purdue. And who would want Purdue, the Boilermakers, playing as poorly as they are? I'll take Purdue this particular week, playing Oregon on Friday. They're 12-1 to the spread. Their last 13 games as dogs of 21 or more points. And you tell me that Oregon's not going to come down or let down in this football game? Give me the Purdue Boilermakers plus the points in a big Oregon letdown.
As usual, Mark is a good 15 seconds in the clear. And it's interesting. Hudson Card, you know, the transfer quarterback from Texas, goes to Purdue. They're really excited, and, well, nothing's happened this year. He gets hurt, goes down against Illinois. This kid comes in, his kid Brown comes in, and he has a monster game. Throws for over 300 yards, 3 touchdowns, no picks. He rushes for, like, over 100 yards. They lose to Illinois by a point, what was it, like 50-49. They go for 2 in overtime. And now that, you know, Card is trying to get back in the game, I'm sure, because he's questionable this week. But I think you're on, by the way, Mark. I was actually even considering, should I even play this as one of my 5 or 6 double-digit upset plays? Because, like you said, I just, this is a great spot to, because, again, it's a wide-open college football season. Who says Oregon is not only going to not come to play, but that somehow this game could actually go into the fourth quarter?
I agree.
I don't think it'll go into the fourth quarter, but this was my sporting news preview I wrote today, so it's probably out there. I'll tweet it out later for those of our audience that follow me on Twitter. But the team totals for this one: Oregon's 44.5, and Purdue is 15.5. I actually think it'll be a competitive game, but not that competitive. And I love the over.
So I'll tell you who's also rooting for Oregon all season: Boise State.
Oh, yeah.
Their lone loss was by 3 at Oregon early in the season, and Boise has a real good chance at going the rest of the way unbeaten. And even if a team, for example, like a Liberty or an Army or a Navy end up going perfect, Boise might still earn that at-large bid because of the quality of competition and the fact that they would have lost to a team that would also perhaps be unbeaten in Oregon.
even though that Illini game went OT, I mean, it's the third game out of six that Purdue has given up 50 points. And only Oklahoma State has given up more rushing yards per game than Purdue. So it's a bad defense. And they're enthused about this kid Brown, like you said. Yeah. So I think points will be a plenty.
Yeah, they're going to upset that. That's what you like in those double-digit upset plays is you'd much rather, all right, if I'd rather have one or the other, I want the offense without the defense because that means that the offense can keep me in it. The other way is not – I don't want an inept offense going up against an elite team. But, we'll see how that takes place. And that is going to be – is that a Friday night game or is that Saturday?
Yes, it is. Yes,
Friday night.
Friday game. So a little bit night action. So we'll see. All right. Next up, Andy, what do you got for us?
I'm going to go to the game that nobody has mentioned, and that's the game between Georgia and Texas. And Georgia, 3.5-point dog right now, maybe up to 4 in some places. The first things that I looked at when this matchup was announced is how have these teams done in certain situations? Number one, how has Georgia done as an underdog? How has Texas done the week after playing Oklahoma? Well, depending upon what you use as a closing line, the last 5 years, Texas is either 0-4-1 or 0-5 against the spread coming off of the Oklahoma game, whether they've won or lost. That's the situation they're in because that's a huge rivalry regardless of who's the better team and who wins or loses the game. Georgia, since 1991, they have rarely been an underdog in non-SEC games. But in the 18 times that they've been underdogs against non-SEC teams, they're 14-3-1 against the point spread. And that includes some years when Georgia was basically an average team. I feel compelled in this game where you've got two outstanding teams. And remember, when two really good teams meet, one really good team is going to lose. And I think that team this week that's going to lose is Texas. I'm taking the points with Georgia, and I'm going to have them on the money line.
All right. 5 seconds over for Andy. So just a little bit of for me.
He's getting it down there. He's getting it down.
Yeah.
And I like it.
Yeah. Matter of fact, Mark and I are going to talk about the Georgia Texas game on the RLADS football channel. So you can check us out there. That's one of the top three games of the week that we're going to talk about in college football. We'll do the NFL as well and go over some of those double digit upset plays matter of fact, the other game we did last week was Vandy over Kentucky. Mark.
Yep, so exactly right.
That was a
nice
one.
There's been this little yin and yang thing going with Kentucky this football season. It's kind of unique where they dress up as dogs, sometimes double-digit dogs. They pull the upset, then they get beat. Then they go back to the other double-digit dog. They pull the upset again. Now, again, here they're the dog this week against Florida. You know, can they take the Gators down? Absolutely, they can take the Gators down. Much, much the better defense here. So Kentucky's been a very predictable, if you will, dog so far this football season.
Okay.
I wonder what the line in that game would have been if Mertz were still healthy for Florida, because Florida was really starting to play some really good football, following that ugly loss to open the season at Miami.
Yes, they were.
That's exactly what Mark and I talked about. It was like, you know, how do we know that Florida is not, this isn't the beginning of the comeback for Napier and the program, the way they've been playing. They didn't even have their top player the last few games. Their wide receiver's been out, and they're still playing like this. So, yeah, that's unfortunate. I hope they give him the benefit of the doubt. But, look, they're really high on this kid. I don't know what you guys think about this Lagway kid. He's got one of those arms and athleticism, but I don't know if he's going to be able to, like, quickly kind of put it together to save Napier's job, but I hope so.
He's Anthony Richardson all over again because he's that unbelievably talented. Yep. But he's in the fire. And unless Napier wins out, he's not keeping that job. The Gators boosters want him out. They've already collected the money. I was stunned that he actually coached against Mississippi State and then lasted the bye week. So he's a goner. He would have had to have held on against Tennessee.
A dead man walking is what you're saying, Tom.
Dead man walking, guaranteed.
Right. Do we have any early favorites for the job? Anybody out there you think that might fit for the Florida Gators, next head coach?
Everybody keeps saying Lane Kiffin, and obviously would be step up.
Lane Kiffin, college football's version of the NBA's Larry Brown.
Just stay where you are. Stay somewhere.
Everybody's saying that Lane Kiffin would leave Oxford for Gainesville. He's even joked around about it he's got a great Twitter account. But whether he'll do it or not,
he at Florida Atlantic for a while?
Yes.
Yeah, he was at FAU for a while, and he got Ole Miss.
That was his first big coaching job, if it was big, but it got him launched anyway. But, yeah, you know, he would leave Mississippi to take a job at Mississippi Community College if there was enough money involved in it for Lane Kiffin.
Well, I mean, he's ridden the spectrum. He was the wonder kid and then, you know, kind of fell off at SC. And then now he's did the FAU redemption tour. And now he's, I mean, I would say he's a top 10 coach in the country.
I'll tell you what, I've said it before, Barry Odom of UNLV, it's going to take a lot of money, I think, to buy him out of his contract here, but he may get the best available job, or certainly be offered the best available job at the end of the season.
How old is he?
Barry, I want to say mid-50s, maybe.
Okay, all right. He's not yet ready to be too old for a young program, but he wins.
I think his son is playing at Arkansas.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. And he might go to Arkansas if Pittman's out, but let's see what Arkansas does this week against LSU.
Oh, he's done a great
job. Yeah, and I think Pittman hangs on. They like him there.
He's done a great job.
Oh, and who's the next NFL coach to get fired?
The one who may end up taking up residence in London.
Well, wait. Yeah. See, you're
and I don't mean Gerard Mayo.
That's a good one, Andy, because we talked about that last week about Peters and whether or not he'd come back. And I completely agree with you because I'm taking New England upset. Jacksonville this week is my only NFL upset because I think he could be done. And matter of fact, this was going to be how I was going to start with the coffee club segment. Because I think it was just today, under Sports Chat with Mark. So thanks for the lead in, Jim. Shelley from Chicago, maybe it was Jim from Las Vegas, wanted to say, with the recent firing of Jets head coach Robert Saleh, what other NFL coaches are on the hot seat? Mark says the NFL season hasn't reached its halfway point, but it's clear that specific teams are either heading in the right direction or the wrong. With those heading south, this could be the list of NFL coaches whose seats are warming up. Jaguars, Doug Peterson is heading the list. You just know that if the slumping Jags lose to the punchless Patriots, Peterson will be handed the pink slip. Other coaches who are doing their best to avoid butane torches include Nick Sirianni, Brian Daboll, Zach Taylor, and as always, Mike McCarthy.
Not on that list that should be, and Mark, you should be familiar with it, Kevin Stefanski of Cleveland. And the reason being is I have to believe that if this guy knows football, and he does, Jameis Winston should be starting instead of Deshaun Watson. So my thought is that Watson is being started because the owner is paying that big money to him, and at some point Stefanski has to say, I'm here to win games.
Well, you're right about that, Andy, because he's made the statement that
a couple of us have some pretty good connections in Cleveland. I'm going to tell you right now, Haslam won't let him bench him.
That's exactly
that's what. Right. Yeah, that's exactly. And at some point, Stefanski has to.
That's not Stefanski's fault.
No, I'm saying that at some point, Stefanski's going to say, I can't work here anymore. And I'm going to start him and go ahead and fire me.
The problem is it's a lot of money, and, you know, that's walking away from money is tough.
No, but the fans don't care. The fans want wins. They don't care if the guy's playing quarterback for free or taking up 50% of the salary cap.
Why did they get away from Mari Cooper? Why did they do that?
Thank goodness. I thought that was a
drop.
Come on. That guy was a stiff this year.
Apparently, the teammates weren't all that upset.
Nobody wants to play there anymore. They don't want to play because it's a joke. Watson is a bum.
Yeah, that's why I think Stefanski is on the list, but not necessarily deserving. So he's a good coach. Correct. We saw what he did when he was allowed to play the players he wants.
And by the way,
I want to just throw this in, in case you don't know.
You talk a little bit closer to the screen, Jim.
The London game, by the way, it predicted it to be terrible rain, up to 40 or 50 mile an hour wind gusts. And they don't know about the playing surface because it's a new surface that hasn't been used before. So that whole thing could be a mess. The most likely bet there would be the under. But we don't really know what's going to happen there. But it's all bad. It's looking bad.
Wasn't there a coach that coached in London that lost a game and got fired after the game?
Is that Dennis Allen of the Raiders?
And had to fly home not on the team plane. Do you recall who that was? That might be the case for Peterson this week.
It could be. It could be. Yeah.
Right. I think they should get rid of Ryan Nielsen, the defensive coordinator there, before Peterson. Peterson's won a Super Bowl. I don't think they're ready to give up on him yet. Nielsen, he looks clueless on the sideline. anytime you see him, they almost blew that Colts game because he was in the wrong defense, and then you give up four touchdown passes to Caleb Williams, who I like, but, I mean, obviously he's not at a level where he should be throwing.
In fact, the Jaguars had a 10-point lead in the fourth quarter in that game, and Indianapolis caught him, and it was a game-winning field goal. It's not like they went up by 10 and Indianapolis scored a touchdown to pull within three. They actually caught him. And that started with the game opening week against Miami, where they're leading basically the whole way, and then the same thing against Buffalo a few weeks ago, where that they ended up giving up the lead and winning on the field goal at the end of the game. Jacksonville has given up more leads, I think, probably this year than many teams have over a three-year period.
Well, that's a great point to bring out, Tony. Statistically, again, tearing into the midweek alert newsletter, Jacksonville's first five football games, they allowed season-high yards to all five opponents. Season-high yards, five out of five. Something's wrong there in Jacksonville, and it's not all Trevor Lawrence. It's that defense is what it is.
Yeah, keep in mind their tackling machine, the kid from Yale, he's been out for a while. Their number one corner has been out for a while. And let's also recall back in week one when they had the big lead late in the third quarter, they lost the game because Etienne fumbled. And he opened up the gates. He would have walked into the end zone.
I got to dial back in, you guys, so I'll be back in 1 minute.
Game would have been over. And but this is what happens. Remember, I mean, Mark, we talk about this every year when the season begins and we go over our predictions that the NFL, especially when we're looking at tough divisions and teams, we're not really sure, you know, who's going to win. We always say this, and that is, this is the type of situation where you don't know which team is going to be able to deal with injuries, turnovers, you know, luck, getting the right calls. And that's what the NFL has become for a lot of teams every year. You know, just look at the Jets. They could be 5-1, but they're 2-4 because they're not finishing at the end of games. That's the difference in the NFL with a lot of teams. And I think Jacksonville's, you know, we know they're talented enough, but they're just not putting it all together. Now, when you watch them play, too, the reason why I think it's Pat Peterson is because when you watch them play, you could just tell there's something wrong. They're just not reacting the way that you would want a team to react.
There was a book written about 40 years ago, Larry Merchant, The National Football Lottery, NFL, and that explains why we love the game and what the game has really become. And I don't know what the numbers are, but just take a look at how many times the final score of the game has changed the point spread outcome.
No. Yeah, way more often than people would really truly realize.
Two weeks ago, 8 games were decided in the last minute.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, when did see the other thing with I'm not going to sit here and try to defend Watson, who hasn't played well, but let's keep in mind that nobody can now tell anybody that having a really good offensive line coach doesn't matter.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Throw in the fact that they've had injuries on the offensive line. Throw in the fact that they're a running team without one of the best running backs who hasn't yet been able to lace it up. And we all thought it was possible that he was going to play right away. As soon as he was able, he was going to play. And that hasn't been the case. So, again, as much as I agree, Watson hasn't played well, but it's so unfair to just put it all on Watson when the offensive line's a mess, the running game isn't there, Cooper's dropping a league-high 10 passes. It's just... You know, and Joku just got back a few games ago.
How was their offensive line last year?
You know, 2 years ago, they were the best offensive line.
Because they had five different quarterbacks last year who were able to win with Cleveland last year.
That's the point. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
A couple years ago, the media was telling you that running backs don't matter anymore. Don't even pay them. Don't draft them. Don't play. You know, and now the best teams in the NFL, if you look, we're going back to square one, old school football. The best teams in the NFL are the teams that can dominate on the running with the running game, which means you have a good offensive line, good running backs, and it gives your quarterback more time to do some.
Six games into the season, Baltimore is averaging 205 rushing yards per game. A lot of it is Lamar Jackson and Derrick Henry. That's still a lot of average, a huge average in this era.
The bigger stat there, Andy.
For Detroit.
Yeah.
Detroit runs it all over.
Green Bay.
Yes.
Detroit, Green Bay, right. Even San Francisco, they're fifth in rush attempts. It's rush attempts is what really counts.
Would even be better. Right.
Baltimore rushes for so many yards because the attempt rushes more often than any other team does.
I think that's the same thing with Green Bay.
Yes. And when you make that statement about it being running backs having no value anymore, Jim, when that was said and everybody was waving that flag, I thought to myself, what a fallacy.
Yep. You're
going to tell that to Gale Sayers and Jim Brown and the legendary running backs that they wouldn't have a place in this National Football League as a place today? Pure garbage.
They're paying $60 million to the quarterback and then don't give him a running back for blocking and screen everything. And then the offensive line doesn't get paid and they get killed. I mean, it's crazy. Who's thinking of this shit?
It'll be back.
This offensive line for Cleveland, as Greg mentioned, is absolutely in threads. Just in threads right now. And Deshaun Watson stands no chance at all when he drops back to pass the football.
None.
He's getting obliterated back there. So,
well, they've had three offensive linemen missing the whole year.
Yes. Yeah. And all sorts of makeshift positions amongst the other offensive linemen as well.
Yeah, I'm watching the game, the Eagle game, and because I actually had Cleveland as one of my I figured, you know what, they're getting way too many points here. They're not. Come on, I mean, they're getting a little bit healthy. The offensive line looked as healthy as it's been all season without Teller, but everybody else is in. And then what happens the first couple of plays? Was it the second play or the third play, Mark? They lose their center.
Yep.
It's like you got to be kidding me. So. Yep. You know, that's what happens. Teams go through this, and you never know when it's going to happen. You can have a rash of injuries, but it's happening to the Cleveland Browns, and it's just looking like they're not going to be able to recover.
Well, they had the best offensive line coach in the National Football League, and then he leaves to join his kid when he took the job at Tennessee. So things began falling apart for the Browns at that point, and then you add injuries into the mix, and all of a sudden, it's a can't-win situation.
It's like a half a century curse of the Cleveland team is unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Offensive line coaches and even, you know, special team coaches, you know, they're a lot more valuable than people think. And I think they should get paid accordingly. I'm going to wrap up with some of the top comments.
I just want to add that by the way, 60 years and Cleveland's one of a very few franchises never to have made a Super Bowl.
And they haven't also won a World Series, right? And how long?
Oh, they won a World Series in 1948. Yes.
Yeah.
Now the question is, can they win one game against the Yankees?
Yeah. What a big surprise. They're on their way to being swept by the Yankees. That's a surprise.
Not so fast.
Sorry about that.
Let's see their bullpen tonight.
I'd like to see them win one game just to save face, you know?
Let's wrap up with the comments of the week. And again, we appreciate everybody's questions and comments here on the YouTube channel. Manuel Hernandez 9448 says, great show again, fellas. Glad to hear from the master, Mark Lawrence.
My man. Gotta put him in the fan club.
Will Hildebrand 1313 in quotes, bye week for Hurricanes. This was, of course, taken from, I think, Mark, you were the one who said that. I was in Biloxi for Katrina, so any Hurricane bye week would be appreciated. Good stuff, men. Thanks. DP Jacobs 28. The production of the show has been fantastic, improving all the time. Shout out to Greg, assuming he's behind the production. Keep on keeping on.
And who sent that? Greg D? Was that from Greg D?
No, that was actually from my dad.
Oh, okay.
Bones River 5786. You are a handicapping genius. I've been checking you out for last 4 years, and yes, you are the real deal. Anyone who doesn't invest in your reading material, playbook, and advice are missing out on what it feels like to win big money. So that's again, Bones River 5786. He's a big fan of yours, Mark.
Well, we like big fans like that, Greg. No question about that. And I really warmly appreciate all the kudos. They're very, very deeply appreciated.
And that'll wrap up the segment.
And well worth it. I read both yours and Andy's every week. Excellent stuff.
Well, I knew one thing, Jim, that when you walk away after you've read those newsletters, I would bet you know more after you walk away than you did before you read them.
Well, my memory base isn't very good anymore, so short-term, long-term kind of thing, but I definitely
as long as the short term lasts from the time you get out of the car and make it to the betting window.
You're right about that.
That's the most important thing. Yes.
It's good stuff though. Everybody should get those sheets.
Well, thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, guys, another great show we had this particular week. We're going to put the final wraps on the show. I want to thank everybody out there for tuning in and listening. And remember, once again, hit the subscribe button. And down below, we would love to have you be a subscriber and the thanks button as well. Until next week, once again, this is Mark Lawrence reminding you to always remember to bet with your head, not over it. And good luck as always.